Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Rogue Regiment by Martha Carr and Michael Anderle. Narrated by Devon Sorvari. Chapter 1. The Key Bank was as dark and empty and securely shut down for the night as every other building at 11:27 p.m. in Salt Lake City, Utah. Just not securely enough. If anyone had bothered to take a closer look, they would have seen flickering lights inside the bank lobby that didn't look like the normal blinking lights from security cameras and silent alarm systems. They would have seen a miniature flash of movement here, a tiny streak of color there, and the doors to the cash and safe deposit vaults slowly opening on their own. They wouldn't have been able to make sense of what they saw happening inside this key bank branch. It would have looked like fireflies were pulling money out of everywhere close to midnight when everyone else was safely tucked in bed. This was just another night for the roving gang of pixies that was pulling off one hell of a bank heist. A well-trained gang of pixies, actually, led by Kalinda, who had handpicked every one of them for a particular skill set. Back on Oriceran, they had a rep, and the gruesome, troublesome prison had been mentioned more than once. But here, it was a different story. How's the security system looking, Marv?
A freaking joke, just like the last one.
Bill, I'm finally gonna get that Barbie car. You know, the one, the hot Corvette? Look at all these bags they left us. I feel like I owe them a thank you note.
You know you can fly anywhere, right? Tiny wings on your back?
Yeah, but it's nice to have choices.
What are you waiting for, Kilder? Use the bags and fill them up.
Hell yeah.
Hasher, what did I tell you about tagging the walls like that when we're on a job? Yelled Kalinda. Small can be beautiful was spray painted in neon orange on the wall.
Aw, come on, Kalinda. I was just...
What did I say?
I'm leaving clues behind. But how does that give us away? Nobody here will think magic. They'll think vertically challenged thieves.
Quit tagging the walls and get back to work. We don't have a lot of time.
Sure, sure. No problem.
Hasher added a spray-painted ant, his tag, and flapped his wings, zipping back to the teller drawers. Kalinda rolled her eyes, but was smiling at the same time.
Remember, we got into this to also have fun, said Kilder, still stuffing a bag with $20 bills big enough for him to use as a bath towel.
It's fun till they catch us. Okay, everybody, hurry up. 10 minutes to take whatever you want and trash the rest. Then we're out of here. A cash drawer at one of the teller windows pinged open, and a lime-green flash of light darted down from the ceiling and hit the open drawer with a jingle. A squeaking grunt of frustration rose from the pixie behind the counter.
Seriously? I finally get the thing open, and all they put in here are rubber bands and paper clips.
I could use some of those to make a hammock. Save me some, will you?
Asked Hasher, his wings beating so fast they looked like a blur of glowing blue.
Bill, you help me? The bank's closed, Sid. They keep all the money over there by the... Well, look at that. Vernon got into the teller's cash safe. Guys! Hey, guys!
Loose bills shot up from the open safe under the drive-through teller window, then fluttered all over the place in a rain of rustling green.
Look, it's snowing. That can be your cut, Vernon.
What? This is my idea of fun.
Whatever you want, man, it's your cut.
Has anyone seen the triplets? Snorts and high-pitched snickers filled the bank's lobby.
I saw them headed for the safe deposit vault. They're probably Scrooge McDuck in another crazy pile like last time.
Vernon did a backstroke, floating a foot across the lobby, kicking his small feet.
Yeah, they're good at that, aren't they? Let's get a move on, pixies. We don't have all...
The pixies' laughter echoed across the lobby.
What am I saying? Of course we have all night. There's nobody here.
The pixies flittered back and forth across the lobby and behind the teller windows, laughing and falling all over each other, shoving cash into bags at the same time. Fun is fun, but they were well trained. In the end, the mission came first. Three of the pixies in Kalinda's gang, affectionately nicknamed the triplets by the others, were too far away to have heard everyone laughing in the front of the bank. It was hard for Z. Thornbrook to hear much of anything beyond the click and scrape of the cylinder in the lock housing, moving with agonizing slowness as she pushed it with both hands from inside the lock. Dark tattoos of different numbers, one per finger, stood out against her pale skin. Speculation in the group was that the numbers were a combination to something valuable on Oriceran. But Z wasn't the type to share information, and her ability to throw a punch or a magic spell at the slightest provocation was very well known. She would tell them when she was ready, or never. A murmur of laughter reached them, and Z's pointed ears twitched, taking it in.
"They sound like they're wasted," her cousin Domino muttered. "Think we should wrap it up pretty soon?"
Z grunted and doubled down on her efforts to push the mechanism's tiny pieces into place without the key. "After I get this one open, I have a real good feeling about what's in here." Domino positioned himself in front of the vault's single long table and didn't flinch when a box beside Z popped open with a metallic clang. A flash of beating wings, the color of dull steel, darted out of the box, zipped over, and stopped beside Domino with a soft pop. A gray pixie was quickly growing to the size of a small seventh grader, crowing Domino. He was used to it.
"I got this, Echo," said Domino.
He was the quiet elf's brother and protector. The two of them were part of the pixie clan from the mountains of Oriceran. They were known for their ability to get in and out of tight, tiny crevices and then grow large enough to push rocks out of the way. Echo had landed perfectly, appearing next to her brother in front of the table, towering over him. She was dressed in black fishnets, knee-high combat boots, and a tank top with dozens of rips across the back. Just how she liked it. Echo was the quiet one amongst them, with a lot going on inside. Everyone in the gang knew not to underestimate her. The added size was needed occasionally for bigger jobs when a pixie's natural tiny stature wouldn't cut it.
"Trolls have got nothing on us," Domino trumpeted, flying around his sister in a quick circle.
As she folded her glittering black wings against her back, Echo leaned toward her younger brother. Her straight black hair fell over half her face like a thick curtain, framing a thin scar that ran down the side of her nose. No one ever asked about it. Domino made sure of that. And besides, Echo would not have answered. She tucked a lock of hair behind her ear and whispered in Domino's small ear. Domino relayed.
"She says, that's what you said about the last three boxes on the last three jobs."
"Even a larger size, she won't say something directly to me," muttered Z, shaking her head.
"Well, Echo, you're not wrong."
Sighing, Z double-checked how far she had left to push. "And technically, I didn't not find really good stuff inside all of them." Domino snorted and folded his arms, his golden brown wings twitching against his back.
"At this point, I honestly care more about getting out of here before Bill and Hasher start another contest to see how far they can throw each other. Still, not sure why you're into all this money. I mean, we're magicals," he said, holding his arms out wide. "It's kind of like a language thing. If you want to trade with humans, you have to speak their language."
"And money talks," Z retorted with another grunt of effort. "Be grateful this stuff is still protected by vaults and alarms. I mean, me? I keep the important stuff stuffed inside an enchanted drawer or a tree stump with a few trolls I can slip some elderberry honey. That's their love language." Oh, right. Instead of a bank without wards or protective spells, so any magical can break right in and take whatever they want. Z leaned sideways against the cylinder and smirked. Not just any magical dom. Us. Echo leaned toward her brother again to whisper in his ear. Domino playfully rolled his eyes. She says if you don't use magic to open that lock, she will. That's not the point, and it could alert the Silver Griffins. Then we would have a problem. She says you're wasting... Yeah, I get it. Z pushed away from the cylinder and stood up inside the lock, glaring at the mechanism that shouldn't have been so difficult to push into place. She flicked her finger at it. A bolt of bright blue light burst from her fingertip and clanged against the metal cylinder. Silver Griffins be damned, she muttered. The last millimeter of metal slid into place the way she wanted, and the deposit box's lid sprang open. Z looked through the keyhole at her human-sized cousins, giants compared to their natural pixie dimensions. I pushed it most of the way there. Uh-huh. What was that? Domino looked at his wrist and the non-existent watch on it. A whole 5 minutes? Woohoo! Hey, I'm trying to be a little more disciplined. Z jumped off the box, and her shimmering blue wings, the same hue as her short hair, carried her up and over the table toward her cousins. With a soft pop, she grew to human size as well, standing on the other side of the still snack-sized Domino. All three pixies stared at the open box. Echo studied Z for several seconds before whispering in her brother's ear again. Domino snickered. She says, forget 5 minutes. Do you have any idea what a zap could have done in 5 seconds? He was floating between the two, glancing back and forth. Z's ears twitched, and she stared at his sister. We're the only ones in here, Echo. You don't have to keep... Yeah, but the others could walk in here at any second, Domino interrupted. She's not gonna talk. Z glanced at the open door of the vault and shrugged. I do know what a fun little zap can do, by the way. I'm just trying to spice things up. You know, add a challenge every once in a while. Her cousins choked back their laughter with poorly muffled snorts. This is why our family reunions turn into food fights. It was true. Hundreds of pixies trying to pull a fast one, always making a joke. It was only a matter of time before someone threw a plump blueberry at somebody else. It always ended in a family picture, tiny arms around each other, decorated in tomato sauce and saffron. She fixed them with a deadpan stare. You think that's funny? Grand theft isn't a challenge to you? You don't need a challenge, Z. Domino's voice trembled in his attempt not to laugh at her. You need a life. I have a life. I spend it keeping you two ingrates alive and out of troublesome. Echo whispered in her brother's ear, and he nodded vigorously in agreement. She says you need a hobby, so add that to the list. Or a date. I added that one. Oh, yeah, thanks. Screw you, too, Z snickered. Her cousins laughed harder, Domino landing on Echo's shoulder. Z nodded at the deposit box Echo had opened. Find something useful in that, huh? Domino, you doing another one? Nah. With a grimace of distaste, he adjusted his hands on the large duffel bag he'd been holding open for the women the whole time. I like it right here, where it's easy to see everything. You don't want me crawling into any more locks anyway. I'd just end up showing you how it's really done. Uh-huh. Keep talking. Shaking her head, Z rubbed her hands together over the safe deposit box, fingers twitching. Gimme something good. She pulled the lid of the box back and let it ping against the table, disappointment instantly washing over her. Another watch? Seriously? Think it's real? Domino asked.
that's not my area of expertise, dude. I don't know. Somebody bothered to put it in here. Well, toss it in the bag. If it's junk, I'll wear it. The jingling and clinking of gemstones and metal filled the vault as Echo pulled a gaudy necklace dripping with diamonds and rubies from her box. She shook the heavy piece of jewelry and grinned. Domino barked a laugh. Sure hope those are real. Echo tossed the fabulously valuable necklace into the duffel bag with everything else they'd scored in this room. Z tossed the possibly fake Rolex over her shoulder, and Domino jerked the duffel bag forward to catch it. Personal documents, Z muttered, pulling papers out of the box and tossing them across the table in a scattered mess. More personal documents. This guy must think he's the king of the earth. Domino cleared his throat. Echo says there's no such thing. It's a figure of speech. The siblings shared a confused look. Then Domino wrinkled his nose. Says who? She ignored her cousin and kept rifling through the box. Passports, credit cards, wads of cash in 4 foreign currencies. Might be useful. Weird. This looks like the kind of box that'd have a stupid gun at the bottom, and that's the last thing we need to have around Hasher or Bill. Wait, what? Z froze with a passport in her hand and stared at the last item in the box. It wasn't a gun. What in the world is some man with fake names and plenty of cash doing with Oriceran symbols on a shady-looking package hidden at the bottom of his safe deposit box? And where have I seen this one before? Z tapped the top of a squiggle that ended in an O. The package at the bottom of the box was a little bigger than a standard mailing envelope. Judging by the way it bulged around the middle and pulled at the corners, it was stuffed full of something. Something far more important was locked up with the rest of its owner's mostly useless junk, muttered Z. She looked up at Domino, excited and calm. It's what always happened to her when a job took an unexpected turn. It has to be magical, since, as a general rule, humans didn't go around stamping Oriceran symbols on their paperwork. What is it? Finally find something good? Domino asked, amused. Can I get a look? Domino was the one who was good with puzzles, including symbols. It was why Kalinda picked him. He flew around the box, trying to get a better look, the bag still clutched in his hand. Maybe. Tilting her head, Z studied the package. She didn't want to risk touching a potentially magical envelope and setting off a spell. Whoever this guy is, he's got... Hey, triplets! A sharp smack came from the open vault door. Riverly was standing there with a crooked smile, her hand on the door. Wrap it up. Boss says it's time to move. Yep. Domino slung the stuffed duffel bag onto the table, pushing aside several deposit boxes they'd looted. 2 slid off the table and crashed to the carpeted floor, scattering the contents. That one's on me. He tugged the zipper shut with 1 swift movement and threw the bag's strap over his shoulder. Leave it, said Riverly. There's no time. Echo whispered in her brother's ear again. He leaned away from her to fix her with a dubious frown. Yeah, I know it's night, but nobody says all in a night's work. Or do they? Z, you have any idea? I don't know. Elves? Are they real? With the clock ticking, Z snatched the package stamped with Oriceran symbols, grinning when it didn't give off magical vibes. That didn't mean there wasn't any magic there, but at least it didn't blast her across the room because she touched it. She stuffed the package into the side pocket of her bomber jacket and spun toward the door. Let's go. She hurried out of the vault first, followed by Domino with the bulging, jingling duffel bag slung over his shoulder. Last to leave the vault was Echo. She eyed the mess they'd made of the vault. She smacked her hand on the table,
the fallen pieces of paper and jewelry dancing in the air till they settled, forming a neat pyramid.
There, she whispered,
her own style of tagging. The gray pixie walked out after the rest of her family with a smirk.
Chapter 2
Z and her cousins rejoined the rest of Kalinda's gang in the lobby of the bank. All right, you know the drill, Kalinda called as she scanned the pixies forming a circle with her, Echo and Z still taller than the rest. Everybody in.
Hell of a haul.
Can't wait to lay all this out on the table and roll around in it.
Just don't break the table, said Z.
Easy for you to say. You're the size of a healthy dwarf.
I'm gonna choose to take that as a compliment.
Z shrunk back down to pixie size, Echo following suit. The lobby echoed with the laughter of a dozen satisfied pixies as they tossed their zipped, tied, twisted, and stacked loot into a chaotic pile in the center of the circle. The last item to crash on cash-filled bags was a cash drawer ripped from its bolted slot at a teller window. Kalinda glanced at the pixie who'd tossed it in.
Bill, not again. We've talked about this. You can't take pieces of the buildings.
Aye, aye, Cap'n.
With hair so light and fine it was almost clear, and eyelashes, eyebrows, and wings to match, Bill looked ridiculous when he gave their ringleader a sloppy salute. Kalinda raised one fuchsia eyebrow.
What were you planning to do with a cash drawer?
He shrugged and let out a noncommittal hum before wiggling a pinky in his ear.
Home away from home? Make a little nest? Something like that. A few good rains and that thing will rust,
Hasher cut in with a giggle.
Hey, you don't know that. I could insulate it.
Bill could build anything and had gotten them out of more than one scrape. Kalinda picked him for the team after she caught him stealing silver hoop earrings from a willin, not an easy task, and followed him to find the home gym he was creating. The other pixies laughed, and Kalinda adopted a knowing but bemused smile. Then she shrugged, too.
Sounds good to me. Time to go. Fire it up.
They were the right distance apart, so every pixie settled their left hand on the shoulder of the magical on their left. When Domino's hand came down on Z's shoulder and gave it a playful squeeze, she shot him a sidelong glance and a crooked smile.
Like this is the most exciting part of what we do. Please, it's not even close.
Kalinda led the gang by pointing her right hand at their huge pile of loot. Everyone else did the same. The air crackled and popped with the sudden flare of combined, powerful magical energy. Z smiled at the intensity of the tingling buzz that raced over her body. She bit her lip to hide how much she enjoyed the sensation. Lurch let out an unabashed giggle. Grulo barked a laugh, then pretended to look embarrassed that anyone else had heard it. Hasher's face was flush from the connection to the others. Even Kalinda was grinning at the swirl of euphoric energy racing from pixie to pixie in a continuous circle of superpowered magic few of their kind ever got to experience. Even fewer could create it on demand. From the other side of Domino, Echo whispered in her brother's ear. He snickered, then relayed her comment to the rest, who were used to the way the siblings worked. She says this is even better than Bird's peach-flavored moonshine. Everyone cracked up, though no one removed their hand from their neighbor's shoulder or stopped pointing at the pile.
Rock and roll, my pixies, Kalinda murmured through a hazy, drunken-looking smile.
Those were the magic words. Each pixie funneled the buzzing, humming energy they'd created into their hands and back out. Streams of light in varying colors and levels of brightness burst from a dozen fingertips. The combined light grew so brilliant that the bank lobby filled with its blinding brightness. Then it winked out. Outside in the parking lot, a homeless man shuffled by, pushing a rickety shopping cart from Harmon's, decorated with a faded blue bandana tied at the front, marking his property. It was impossible for him not to notice the blinding flash of light that flared to life inside, and he stopped to watch the show with awestruck eyes. After the light disappeared, he blinked as if he were coming out of a daze, shook his head, then shuffled onward in his nightly route around the city.
Nah, can't be. Gotta stop eating out of the Taco Bell dumpster. First, a large, furry Cupie doll with green hair starts talking to me, and now this. Of course, he shared a donut. That was real. That's a friend. Now, what was his name?
Scratching his head, he rattled the cans nestled on the pile of his belongings in the shopping cart, proud to have savings that couldn't be touched by bankers, aliens, or pixies. If he'd stopped to look closer in the bank, he would have seen a dozen tiny glowing lights of many colors forming a perfect circle on the bank lobby's floor. However, he had places to be, and no one else was walking down that street at 12:14 a.m. in Salt Lake City. Inside, Kalinda lowered her hand from her neighbor's shoulder, still grinning.
Whew, gets me every time.
The other pixies let go as well. Some kept their eyes closed as the buzz and pixie-induced high faded. All were smiling. Z's eyelids fluttered, and she gave a drowsy, contented sigh.
Good times.
All right, fun part's over, Kalinda called out. The pile of loot in the center of the circle had shrunk to pixie size. Well, the funnest part, she said with a wink. Let's complete the mission.
That's not a word, and I still love it,
Marv laughed as he stepped forward to grab whatever bags he could get his hands on.
Funnest part of doing what we do,
Bill added, stooping to pick up the bulky cash drawer.
My new apartment,
he said, trying to hug it.
That's very sad, dude,
said Hasher. One by one, they picked up the loot, and when the magically reduced pile had been strapped over shoulders and backs, Kalinda pointed at the ceiling where it intersected with the side wall of the lobby. Everyone knew what she meant. The buzzing hum of a dozen pairs of fluttering wings filled the air as every pixie launched off the lobby floor in a glowing ball of colored light. Letting out a high-pitched whistle, the pixie gang sped toward the air vent their ringleader had pointed at, racing each other and bobbing. Z couldn't stop hiccuping. She was still intoxicated by the intense magic they'd used to shrink their haul. Even with the glowing lights of her fellow winged thieves zipping in spirals and curlicues around her, it was a straight shot to the vents. Just as they'd planned. As if pixies ever followed a plan in a straight line. It was what made it so hard to catch them. There was a plan, but only a pixie would be able to see it. When they were through the air vent and racing down the square metal tunnel behind it, the buzzing of their wings and high-pitched whistling were magnified. The only sound that didn't belong was the hard metallic clink Z heard as she followed her cousins. She stopped and looked down to see Bill's cash drawer lying on the floor of the vent. Bill hovered above her, flexing his hands.
That sucker is still awkward to carry.
Rolling her eyes, Z waited for the last few pixies to race past her with their hauls before she dove toward the cash drawer. It wasn't as heavy as she'd expected it to be, even at its current size. She picked it up and clutched it against her chest, then took off after the others. When Bill saw her, he stopped whistling and dove toward the glowing blue pixie carrying his new metal nest.
Hey!
Hey,
she fixed him with a lazy smile.
That's mine.
You dropped it.
Bill's face scrunched in a mixture of magical intoxication, confusion, and irritation.
It's not finders keepers, Z.
Get your own. He grabbed the cash drawer with both hands and yanked it from her arms. Z slowed and glared at the back of Bill's red glowing wings. That was uncalled for. Fine, she hollered after him, picking up the pace. When she caught up with him, she waited for Bill to notice she was grinning like a lunatic. His eyes widened just as she shoved him aside and raced ahead. Keep it. Bill tumbled and hit the side wall with a muffled clang, still smiling. It always took a while for the magical surge to wear off. Till then, Pixie Mischief only rose. The other pixies looked back. He was dizzily fluttering to the bottom of the vent. The last few pixies giggled, lazily bobbing their heads. Bill, that was Z101 after a heist. You got schooled. After all this time, you still don't know how Z works, huh? Give her the finger, and she'll give you the whole damn fist. When he'd recovered enough to understand what had happened, Bill shook his head and giggled as he clutched the cash drawer to his chest. Then he went airborne again to race after the others. Z flew backward to make sure she saw he was still okay. You should know better, she said, the typical edge to her voice. Bill chose that moment to flip her the bird, and she raised a fist in warning. He dove to skim the bottom of the air vent so he could put the other pixies between them. Humming a long-forgotten tune to herself that always calmed her down, Z caught up with her cousins and flew alongside them as the gang burst out from the other end of the air vent. They filled the night sky with colorful lights. Whooping and cheering, Kalinda's gang flew loop-the-loops, spirals, and zigzags in celebration, still half-drunk on the magic they'd used to pull off their latest job without ever triggering the bank's security alarms. Pixies rule! Yelled Hasher, whistling. Chapter 3. Miles away, in the woods at the foot of Utah's Mount Wire, Kalinda's gang returned to their temporary hideout. Still whooping and shouting, the colorful point of light dove into a rotting log located half a mile off a walking trail. Half the log was open to the elements and the fresh air. The other half was enclosed by decaying wood that would maintain its structure for another month, assuming nobody stepped on it during an impromptu venture off the trail. Some magicals would have worried about that plausible threat to their home. Kalinda's gang, however, had been roaming across the country for the last 150 years, hopping from one temporary landing pad to the next out of necessity. No other magicals dared to pull off the kind of heists these pixies took on and then stuck around the area. That's why they kept moving. Well, one of the reasons. It was another trait Kalinda had spotted that made them a good fit. None of them liked to stay in the same place for very long. They were all used to abandoning or destroying their previous homes before setting off to find new, fresh, and exciting places to settle down and cause havoc behind the scenes. Kalinda had collected the band of pixies because they were the outcasts and the misfits on Oriceran, always in trouble somewhere. But she could see something else. They had potential, if only someone would pay attention long enough and let go of their ideas about pixies in general, or fun, for that matter. This rotting log had been their home for just over 3 weeks, and like every other place they'd chosen to temporarily call home over the decades, the gang had turned it into a chaotic, eclectic, easily disassembled paradise, full of bits and pieces from other places. Their idea of home, or at least a temporary one, and more than any of them had ever known before they became a family. The stealing was a way to get by, and get back at everyone who saw pixies as a nuisance or a bother, and especially the rogue rebels, the nickname they had given each other a long time ago. Sure, it was safer to be on Earth than Oriceran, but magic was still hidden, and what was a tiny creature with luminous wings to do? Money gave them a way to bargain with the pockets of humans who knew of their existence and would trade supplies,
or when a better hiding place was needed, or sometimes something fun, like the time Bill traded his share of a job to get everyone a day to themselves at a carnival. No other humans, no other magicals around to give them sidelong glances. Kalinda smiled at the memory, looking at Z, who was bent over her stash, carefully checking it to make sure nothing was missing. She was the toughest nut to crack in the Rogue Rebels. There wasn't anyone she trusted completely, and very few she trusted at all, and they were all in the band of thieves. That was all Kalinda knew of her story, and she didn't ask for more. That was a sure way to earn a scowl, and maybe a jab or two from Z. "She'll tell me when she's ready, maybe," muttered Kalinda. Honesty, or worse, vulnerability, wasn't a requirement of the group. One after the other, the tiny magicals landed on their feet without a sound. Their glow faded when they touched down, and the pixies spread out on what they called the front porch to go through their loot and catalog everything.
"What did you find, Z?" asked Lurch.
"Found," said Z, not looking up or answering him. Hasher grinned, pulling wrapped bundles of cash out of his bag.
"Found," he said, nodding. "Pixie style."
Z and her cousins swooped toward the new couch they'd made, an empty, upside-down sardine can that had been washed in the nearest stream served as the frame. Echo had stripped one black sock from her foot while she was human-sized to serve as its cushioned covering. A broken but still fluffy cattail pod tied to the can with dental floss was the backrest. It was the perfect size for the cousins, and fortunately, neither the sardine can nor Echo's sock had stunk up the place. They were pixies, after all. There were some standards. It's just that they were the only ones who knew them, but they were there. The other pixies dropped their loot and headed to their favorite spot on the front porch. Beds of leaves, cushions of moss, or hammocks made from scavenged medical gauze. Where natural materials or human trash didn't provide satisfying creature comforts, they had the odd bit of shrunken furniture, like Kalinda's crooked papasan chair and Lurch's futon with mustard stains. Z flopped onto the couch, put up her feet, and folded her arms behind her head with a contented sigh. Home, sweet home. Echo sat on the edge of the couch, her back straight and her hands resting on her thighs as she looked over her brother's shoulder. Domino sat on the floor on a fluffy layer of sawdust, conveniently covering up a stretch of decaying wood. He put his back against the couch and their duffel bag between his outstretched legs. The first thing he drew out of the bag was the gaudy necklace of diamonds and rubies. Lifting it on the end of one finger, he shook it and looked happily around the porch. "Any takers on all this oversized icing? Echo, you like to be a full-sized candy bar more than the rest of us." His sister silently shook her head, nudging it away, waiting for the next thing to be pulled out of the bag.
"Icing?"
Hasher looked up from the cash he was counting.
"You found a cake in the bank?"
"Could just be a tub of it," Riverly added, without removing her gaze from the stacks of bills she had laid out in front of her. "But hey, if you found a tub of icing, I'd eat that shit all day long. Almost as good as Bird's peach-flavored moonshine." The other pixies burst out laughing. Bird held up two tiny gold bars, examining their shine in the warm glow of the enchanted lights bobbing above the porch. "How come everybody's comparing things to my hooch?"
"'Cause it's the best damn thing you've made since that farm in California."
"The pot farm? Ha! I didn't make that weed, Marv. I grew it."
"Wouldn't mind some of that now. It'd go real nice with a giant scoop of icing."
Echo whispered in her brother's ear.
"Shit."
Domino jingled the necklace again.
"My bad. I meant ice. All this ice. That's what humans call crap like this, right?"
Only if they're too cool to call it a diamond necklace, Z muttered.
Huh.
Bill stopped fiddling with his cash drawer and stared across the porch with a confused frown.
I thought they called it Bing, like, hey man, check out my Bing.
Hasher and Lurch howled, falling against each other and kicking puffs of sawdust off the floor.
It's bling, Bill. Bling!
Bill shrugged and went back to organizing his snacks in their new home. How hard is it to get a straight answer? Domino asked through his laughter. Necklace with diamonds and rubies, if they're real. I don't have a jewelry guy, so if somebody else knows where to fence this thing, offer's on the table. I'll take it.
Kalinda held out a hand, and he nodded at her before chucking the necklace across the porch.
The finely crafted piece of jewelry lit up with a fuchsia glow and sailed into the ringleader's hand. Kalinda undid the clasp and held the dangling necklace out in front of her. The gemstones sparkled in the enchanted lights suspended in midair above them.
You know what? I think these are real.
Leave it to Kalinda to find a jewelry guy after only a few weeks,
Lurch muttered. He shook his head and chuckled.
Oh, I haven't yet, Kalinda replied casually.
She studied the necklace with the same level of pride as if she'd crafted it herself, then laid the necklace against her chest and clasped it around her neck.
I think it completes my look.
The pixies roared at their leader. She was sitting cross-legged in the lopsided papasan chair in a tattered jeans jacket, oversized sweatpants, fuzzy pink slippers almost the same color as her hair, and a bejeweled necklace that was probably worth more than the entire gang had stolen from every job combined. Reveling in the hilarity and the attention, Kalinda straightened like a queen looking at her subjects, then laughed along with them. A moment later, Z dropped her head on the couch's back cushion and slid her hands into her jacket pockets. It's like a bunch of kids at Christmas around here. She paused when her fingers brushed the bulky package she'd pilfered from the final security box. The Oriceran symbol stamped on the front of the package in crimson ink, without any other identifying marks on the envelope, flashed through her mind. Weird to find something like that in a bank of all places. What would a human have to do with the kind of magic that gets stamped on an envelope? Z started to pull the package out of her pocket, only half listening to the jovial, celebratory chatter of the pixies around her. The gang had become a family to her and her cousins. She stopped when a conversation caught her attention.
Check this out, man!
Grulo shouted as he ripped open a bag to rummage through the contents.
Damn it, Marv! If you chucked a bunch of computer shit into one of our bags again, I swear to the Four Seasons, I'm gonna... Hey, isn't that a hotel? The Four Seasons? What? No, that's the freaking weather on this planet, smartass.
Marv, Callista cautioned, pretending to be perturbed. We talked about stripping computer parts. Hey, I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.